located in Bozeman, Montana, and I think I know all of you. But thank you for taking the time to join us. And why don't we go around and just kind of roll call first, and then we'll Tina and I will kind of. So I just introduced myself. Mary, do you want to go ahead?
Sure. This is Mary McFadden with the Great Northern LCC. I'm kind of behind the scenes today. I'll be monitoring the recording as well as the webinar in case anybody has problems.
And this is Matt Heller with the Great Northern LCC, Data Manager, GIS Administrator, located in Bozeman also.
Okay, who else is on?
This is Chuck Hawkins.
SGS here in Bozeman.
Okay, I heard, let's see, I think I heard Chuck Hawkins' name, so why don't you go ahead, Chuck?
Yeah, this is Chuck Hawkins of Utah State. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Watershed Sciences.
Great. Somebody else was also?
This is Andrea Ray at NOAA in Boulder.
Okay. Hi, Andrea.
Adam Sepulveda, USGS, here in Bozeman.
Great. Adam.
Steve Kettler with Fish and Wildlife Service in Denver.
Thanks for joining, Steve.
Geneva Chong, Northern Rocky Mountain Science Center, Bozeman, and the North Central Climate Science Center in Fort Collins.
Hi, Geneva.
Hi, everyone. This is Linh Hoang. I'm the Climate Change Coordinator for Region 1 of the Forest Service in Missoula, Montana.
And this is Dan Isaac with Forest Service Research, fish biologist in Boise, Idaho.
Okay. Anybody else?
David Thoma
with
Shallcross.
Go ahead, Tom. Tom Olive. Tom, did you just introduce yourself? Are you there? Okay, we lost Tom. Somebody else was talking?
Yep, this is Alden Shallcross over here in BLM in Bozeman, or I'm sorry, Billings.
Thanks, Alden. Thanks for joining us.
Yep.
Hey, and this is Tina Leba.
Hey, Tina. Tom, are you back, Olive? Okay, I don't know. Tom might be having trouble with his audio. Okay, let's see. Let me go through this and just see if there's anyone that hasn't introduced themselves. Or is anyone that hasn't introduced themselves?
This is Britta Bierwagen from EPA.
Okay, that was Britta Bierwagen from EPA. Somebody else?
David Thoma from National Park Service in Bozeman.
Great, thanks, Dave.
And David.
Andy Ray with the National Park Service in Bozeman.
Okay, heard Andy Ray and then one other person.
Yes, this is David Wood from NORAC.
Great, hi, David. David's with USGS and here in the Northern Rocky Science Center. Anyone else?
Mike Tercek, yeah, I'm a contractor for Park Service.
I'm sorry, say your name again?
Mike Tercek, I'm a contractor for the Park Service.
Great, yeah, of course, I have you on the list here. Great, thanks for joining. Anyone else who just joined?
Yeah, that Tom, I had the wrong call-in number, sorry.
Okay, great, thanks, Tom. Okay, so anyone else who has not introduced themselves yet? All right, so has everyone been able to join the meeting?
Is that a yes? Is there supposed to be anything we're seeing at this point?
I don't think so, but I'm actually having trouble getting on, so that's why I'm asking. Are you at Mary? Mary can tell if you're on. Are people on the line?
I can
see
several
people
Chuck
on the
camera.
Line. Yeah. Chuck, we see you.
Okay.
Okay, I don't know what my end of things. You can see me. You can't see my computer, can you?
That's
my name on the register.
So that's why we see him.
Okay, well, let's get started, and then I'll try to figure out why I can't see things on my computer. But just as a little bit of background, I think last winter, Tina Laidlaw from EPA and I were meeting about a number of other things, and this came up, and I'm going to let Tina talk about how this came up, but basically she and I had sort of played phone tag and sort of talking to some people about the interest in a regional climate network, and over a period of time we kind of managed to schedule these three webinars, a series of webinars, and as part of that, this initial one we're going to try to talk about sort of the management perspective, although Andrea Ray from NOAA is going to talk on this one because she can't make the next one. And then the next one is going to be more from a science perspective, and the last one is going to be a discussion session about what are we doing and do we want to take this another step forward. I have mentioned a few times that we're really talking about here is monitoring resources for impacts of climate. I know Andrea from NOAA is also talking about monitoring climate factors or things that help us understand how climate changes. So there's going to be some mixing of concepts here, but we can kind of talk through that. Tina or Britta, did either of you, Tina, do you want to talk a little bit about the background from your perspective?
Sure. Thanks, Yvette. So thanks to everybody for joining today. This has been, as Yvette alluded to, we've been talking about this for a while. And really, I can't take the credit because the idea was really generated when I was meeting with Andy Ray and also with Adam. And Andy's with the National Park Service and Adam's working for USGS. And we were talking about some of their wetlands work that they were doing in the national parks. And so the idea was, well, gosh, isn't this a great opportunity to look at how we might leverage some of the monitoring activities that are already going on out there and begin to leverage kind of resources from different federal and state agencies and to build kind of a climate monitoring network, especially in this region where we do have so many kind of relatively undisturbed landscapes still left intact. And so was there an opportunity to kind of look at these large tracts of land and kind of talk about what some of our key climate monitoring questions might be and decision related questions, kind of what we're going to do with the information, and begin to talk about how we could kind of build from the work that's already going on out there, kind of take that the next step. So that's really kind of the genesis for this idea. And again, thanks to everybody for joining today.
Okay, great. Did we have a couple more people join? I just heard a few more beeps.
Hi, it's Ann Carlson from the Wilderness Society.
Okay, that was Ann Carlson from the Wilderness Society. Thanks, Ann. Anyone else?
Jeff Morissette with the North Central Climate Science Center.
Oh, great, Jeff. I just saw your note, so I'm glad Geneva was able to get that to you. Sorry I missed you on that somehow. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and get started because we have a full webinar here today. And I think we're going to start with, we're going to put Steve Kettler a little bit on the spot. And in part because he informed me that his presentation was going to be pretty short, and he actually, do you have slides, Steve, or are you just going to give us a oral presentation?
I'll just give you an oral presentation. I don't have any slides, but.
Okay, and Steve Kettler works with the newly developing INM program with the National Wildlife Refuge Program. He's located in Denver. You can go ahead and introduce yourself, Steve, and your position, and kind of explain what's going on with that program.
Okay. You guys heard who I am and where I am and all that. And roughly our inventory and monitoring program for refuges is somewhat based on the model the Park Service has had for at least, I think, a decade, if not a little longer. And the effort is probably, well, it's now it's 5 or 6 years old, and we're still evolving and that sort of thing. But to give you the gist of what I think some of the questions I saw and all that with related to the National Wildlife Refuge System here in our region. Our region basically is Montana, North Dakota, south to Utah, Colorado, and Kansas, and the three states in between there. So 8 states, we have 100-plus refuges, not all of them staffed. Many of them are posted, you'd probably consider postage stamps in the big landscape perspective, although where there are a few exceptions, including Charles M. Russell in Montana, a very big place. Our focus of our monitoring through this program and at our refuges is really, it's twofold. It's habitat, both habitat monitoring and species monitoring. Our refuges, by and large, not completely, but by and large, are pretty heavily managed, I think, more so than most people would realize. And especially, I think, a lot of that in terms of water manipulation, trying to grow food for migratory waterfowl is one of the big ones. But also, we do a fair amount of grazing, burning, spraying, a little bit of forestry, and some other things. But by and large, the refuges are relatively heavily managed compared to a lot of some other public lands, I guess I should say. They are pretty small, like I said. One of the additions we have to that 100 plus refuges I talked about is in the Dakotas and eastern Montana. We have waterfowl production areas, and we have several thousand of those smattered around these different counties. Those are fee owned by the public, but they are a lot of times, you know, 100 acres or a couple hundred acres. On an odd occasion, I think you might have 1,000 or a couple thousand acre parcel. And those are really, again, focused on waterfowl production. So our monitoring is, again, to mostly looking at habitat and species. And I would think, I would say our focus is trying to understand patterns and using climate or other indicator data to develop models and that sort of thing to assess our management outcomes. And that's the gist of our monitoring. Not completely. We do have a place or two that has just like climate station kind of monitoring, but we're not actively using that data other than trying to understand the patterns and how that might affect our the things we're trying to manage for. Most refuges have a pretty specific purpose that they were developed for. It might be migratory birds, so it's as broad as that, but there's goals that are sort of drilled down to provide X amount of habitat or try to provide X amount of habitat for X number of critters and that sort of thing. So the way we use, I would think we'd use just general climate or weather data, is to understand how that affects those patterns and the processes associated with those things. We certainly are monitoring, I would say you might call a lot of indicators. We have a lot of water monitoring because we do have a lot of water infrastructure in the region that we're managing and using. That's probably one of the most consistent monitoring things, I think, across the refuge system, probably nationally, even beyond our region. A lot of vegetation monitoring, that sort of thing, and again, species, individual species or groups of species monitoring, waterfowl, breeding birds, a lot of things like that. I think what folks do when they're looking for, if you want to just sort of stick with climate or weather data, is grab the nearest station and use it if they're trying to run a model where they need that information. We haven't had, I only think of one case where a refuge wanted to have a on the refuge weather station or climate station. So we don't have that demand, at least right now. Folks are mostly grabbing what they can. And I think that does sort of come from the fact that we're sort of smattered across the landscape. And usually there's a weather climate station nearby enough that gives them good enough information to try to understand what's going on. But we haven't had too many cases where folks have said they'd love to have something on site, of course, but whether they need it and use it is another question. So I guess I'll leave it like that, unless anyone wants to throw me questions, or if I missed any of the questions or the gist of what you guys were trying to get out of here about.
Thanks, Steve. Any questions for Steve about the National Wildlife Refuge or Region 6 monitoring program? And feel free as we go along to type questions into the chat box, and we'll kind of try to see if we can answer those or people can look at them and respond to them if they want to. The idea is to be pretty open. I think for the next two webinars, we're going to use this WebEx format. For the last one, we're going to use Adobe Connect so we can actually have discussion online while people are talking. That should make things a little easier to share. So if there's no questions for Steve, we'll move on to Andrea Ray. Andrea is from NOAA, and she's going next because she has to get off the call a little bit early. So why don't you, Mary, if you can share. Do you have slides, Andrea?
Yes. And I'm speaking.
Hey, Andrea, I just made you a presenter, so you just have to share your screen and then put your PowerPoint into slideshow mode. There you go.
Does that work?
Yeah, and then just switch to slideshow mode or whatever it is on the lower right-hand corner. Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
There we go.
And I'm speaking through a headset, so if I say it out, let me know. Sometimes it's not obvious to me that it's moved slightly and you can't hear. I have to apologize. I recently got braces, and I feel like I'm lisping, so if something's not clear, just ask me and I'll repeat it. Yvette and I had a conversation a few weeks ago that you were doing this, and I just suggested that maybe if you weren't aware of them, that some of the, and it sounds like a lot of you are, that some of the NOAA monitoring would be, land-based monitoring would be of interest, and perhaps being able to find out where that's being done means that either you can complement things that are already being done or take advantage of it. So let's see, the next slide. Access to most of the land-based, again, there's lots of marine and coastal stuff, but I don't think that's quite as much of a concern for Great Northern. You can get to it from this NOAA program that used to be called the National Climatic Data Center, has recently been at NESDA somewhat reorganized and is now being called the National Center for Environmental Information. Just to make things confusing, even though they're now using the term NCEI, most of the web pages still say NCDC. And so that site, NCEI, provides access and archive to many different kinds of data and derived products. In some cases, they are products that are a combination of actual in-situ data and satellite data, for example, the ones that are actually land-based. It wouldn't be that way, but some other parts of NESDA have some things that are based on satellite data. These products are developed from data cluster collected across the U.S. and then sometimes globally, and the availability varies by data type and station, but some kinds of them actually have periods of records back to 100 years. Some others don't, because in some cases monitoring just didn't start until much more recently. Kind of the big one for actually thinking about climate change, it's what's called the U.S. Climate Reference Network. And it's a set of 114 stations that were actually established as formal climate reference stations. They started being established in the 90s. Sometimes they are adjacent to stations that have been in existence in the same place longer, but this was really designed to detect climate change. And they're placed in pristine environments, expected to be free of development for many decades. I think almost all of them are on federal lands, or in some of them maybe on state lands, so that there's some control over what happens around them. You don't want somebody to build a parking lot next door. And a number of them are in national parks. They were really intended for this detection of climate change, not necessarily regional change. And they're pretty expensive sites because they have a lot of different kinds of sensors and a lot of backup. So there's a map here of where they are. You can go here to this webpage and get more details and see the map. There has been some piloting of a more regional set of networks, climate reference networks. One of those has been deployed in the Southwest, and I think the intent that there's a site about every 100 kilometers. Again, I know this is not really at the granularity of monitoring that you need for a lot of ecological things, but it may be helpful in comparing a site that's nearby to one of these special reference network stations. NCEI also has a lot of climate data online tools that you can do things like search across multiple data sets, locate, there's two words there, sorry. Weather observing stations, looking spatially by a variety of parameters or by observation sites. You can search within a single data set. legacy data tools are sometimes things that are no longer being done, or they've been replaced by some newer kind of data set or some newer kind of observation. But in general, they're still available online from this climate data tools. A couple of them that might be of interest, these are not necessarily legacy data tools, but just additional data tools, are a database of storm events and severe weather. So if you're trying to figure out what might have affected a particular site at a particular time, you can look there and see whether there's a storm event. Maybe you're interested in whether in a year that there was some effect on the species, whether there were winter storms that year. Those kinds of things. And that's the URL for those. So, run by the Weather Service, most of the data station, the observing stations that are not actually at a weather forecast office or an airport, are these co-op observer program stations. And big long URL there, a bunch of different things that are taken, maximum minimum temperature, snowfall, 24-hour precipitation totals. Some stations include additional kind of data, and you'd have to go to a particular station to find out about that. When within this network, there are a number of these stations that are considered higher quality, longer term. They haven't moved. There hasn't been a parking lot built next to them and those kinds of things. And this subset is called the HCN, or the Historical Climatology Network. Those are those co-op stations that are considered part of this higher quality network are the ones in red, the HCN. You can go to a map there and you can read some more details about them at that URL. Another thing that NOAA runs is this set of regional climate centers, and it's a federal and state cooperative effort. The history of that is that they used to be a NOAA program, and in the 80s it was decided that they should be a regional program that was run by the states. So it's now this cooperative effort. In the West, this is the Western Regional Climate Center in the High Plains. They have some kind of fuzzy boundaries. Western Regional Climate Center does most of Wyoming and Colorado. High Plains does less of that, and often High Plains edges over into these other areas that are in the Midwest. Both of them have a lot of derivative products. For example, I was looking around on the High Plains station, and they have trends for temperatures that are thresholds that are important for growing corn in different parts of the High Plains. So often the RCCs, the regional climate centers, develop things that are of particular interest to their region. Sometimes those kinds of derivative products are available in many places, and sometimes it's just for a particular area. Western region RCC in particular has just a lot of different products and data and visualization. And most of the time when they make data available, they're for the whole country, because it's just easy to do. Once you've coded doing that, it's easy to do it for everywhere. So really just a wealth of information on those pages. As an example of one thing that I thought might interest this group is the remote automated weather stations. It's something that WRCC provides access to. Actually, it's run by an interagency project, an interagency effort, and it's nationwide. It was especially designed for fire weather for the Forest Service, and so some of the kinds of data that they take are really focused on air quality and fire weather. Some of the data, the data included is here, and it's relayed to the National Interagency Fire Center via the NOAA GO satellite. But this is a set of data, as I said, remote, that's in many places, especially on Forest Service lands and other forested lands, that may be of interest to you guys. That's all I have. I'd be happy to answer some more questions, any questions there are.
Great, thank you. Any questions? Go ahead.
Oh, thank you, Yvette. Well, this is Ann Carlson, and thank you so much. That was fantastic, as was the one before. And I was wondering if this might be a long answer, so if it's too long, just let me know. But it seems like there is such an amazing amount of data being generated, and not only with sort of general sort of median trends over time, but with these sort of storm or disturbance events potentially. So I'm just wondering how all of you are going about organizing this potential for learning into bite-sized chunks, because it seems like that's a huge ask, but there's a big opportunity here, obviously, which I'm sure you all work on quite a bit. So I wasn't sure if you might be able to sum that up for us a little bit.
I'm not sure how to answer that question. I wasn't really aiming this talk at how it goes out for public consumption. So is that what you're asking about?
Sure, because I just think, you know, about how we are two years into a severe drought in Montana. So what does that look like on the ground? You know, how do these drought events change over time with severity or length, or how can you think?
Yeah, so for the drought example, a lot of the drought-related material data is NOAA works with the USDA and the National Drought Mitigation Center, and they're all part of this thing called NIDIS, the National Interagency Drought Information System. So if you Google NIDS, it might even just be drought.gov is actually their URL. You can find a lot of information about drought there, including some messaging about drought. One of the products that gets picked up on there is the U.S. Drought Monitor, and there's the NOAA Drought Outlook. That's another piece that's there. So if you're particularly interested in drought, that's where a lot of that comes out. I still feel like I'm not quite answering your question, how to get to bite-sized pieces. A lot of these, if you go to the URLs, you can download data for a particular area if you're interested in a particular area or if you're interested in a particular set of variables. But this is mostly focused on what the monitoring is and where you get the data.
That's great. Thank you.
Sure.
There was a request from Dave Thoma to ask if Mike Tercek could go next. So I know we had Alden on for next, but he said this would be a great lead-in. So why don't we just let Mike go next? And Mike, you said you're a contractor for the Park Service. Maybe you can explain about what you're doing. And Mary, if you could move the screen over to Mike, that would be great.
Yeah, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I can hear you. And everyone else, please mute your phone if you're not speaking. Thanks.
Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Great. So my name is Mike Tercek. I work as a contractor for the Park Service. I'm based in Gardner, Montana, which is the north entrance to Yellowstone. And I was going to talk about two things today. One of them is climateanalyzer.org, which is a tool that's been funded by the National Park Service Inventory and Monitoring Network. And then briefly at the end, I was going to talk a little bit about one of the studies we did that will try to forecast snow conditions in the mid and late 21st century. So the goal of climateanalyzer.org, which is the website that we've developed together, my name is on the slide there, but there's been a lot of people, including Dave Thoma and Kristen Legg and Ann Rodman at Yellowstone, that have all contributed ideas, lots of other people too. So it's serving over 60 Park Service units and some Fish and Wildlife Service units. And the goal basically is to take climate data from over 20 different data sources, put it all in one place, sort of standardize the formats, and make it easy to do basic queries and graphs that people have identified as being useful for annual reports or if they want to use the data as covariates in other scientific studies. This isn't actually a complete list of the data sources that we have. I'll show a few more, and I'm going to demonstrate the website in a second. But we've got the co-op stations that were just mentioned, Snowtell, Roz, rain gauges, stream gauges. There's some buoys in the Great Lakes, Canadian weather stations, satellite imagery. We're pretty good at getting new data sources. So if a park or a staff member identifies a different type of data that they want to get, we can usually add it to the website. All of the data is updated at least every 24 hours, and we get the complete period of record of every weather station each time we do a refresh, and that can be important because a lot of times the Weather Service will go back and do quality control on their data, and so sometimes even data that's fairly old can be edited and changed. So we have a complete update of data every day, and we get about 9 gigabytes of data refreshed, we acquire every night. And this is just an example of how some of the data that you download from the standard sources can be difficult to interpret. This is a data record that you get from the Western Regional Climate Center. It's a ROS record from Anacapa Island in California. And the red arrow there is pointing at the precipitation column. And you can see that right by the arrow, that column goes from 2.1 to 2.16. So that means that there was 0.06 inches of precipitation during that hour. So you have to subtract that out. But there's a lot of complexities there. Sometimes you have the rain gauges reset to zero, or sometimes it'll evaporate a little bit, and you'll get waivers in that. And so you have to write code to correctly interpret all these fields. And so one of the goals is, of the website originally, was just to take data sets that look like that and convert it into something like this. It's an easy-to-read table that you can download as a spreadsheet or into a data frame for R if you want to use it for analysis. And so you've got standard precipitation, daily maximum temperature, daily minimum temperature fields indexed by day. I'm going to show the website in a second, but if you go through the menus on there, you can make a pretty good variety of graphs. So you can take data and look at trends over time. This is precipitation at Mammoth Hot Springs in Yellowstone from 1941 to 2015. The dashed line is the average precipitation over that time period, and the blue areas above are above average years, the red areas are below average years, and all the dots behind are actual measurements of precipitation for those years. You can do the same thing with temperatures. So on the top, you've got average daily maximum temperatures for the year, averaged over the year, and then the bottom is average daily minimum temperatures averaged over the year. You can look at trends over time. The green line is the running average of those temperatures. Let's see. Similarly, you can look at stream gauge data. You can just make simple graphs of the time series, or you can do things like compare two time periods. So you can select, any years. So in this case, I just selected 1911 to 1940, and then 2000 to 2015. So you can look at how the hydrograph is changing over different periods of time. Same thing with snowpack. I'm just kind of running through some of the highlight examples. There's a lot of other graphs that you can make. But this is from a snowtell station, and in this case, you're looking at peak snowpack for the year. This is at the northeast entrance to Yellowstone National Park. And so every dot on the graph is peak snowpack for a water year, and then the little annotations by each graph, for example, 323, 429, those are the dates on which peak snowpack occurred. And you can see, at least in this case, at the northeast entrance, that there's been a pretty obvious decline of snow over time. Those are some of the graphs that you can make. You can also do things you can do queries of the data. So this is just an example of how you can ask for a particular weather station, give me the number of days that were below 0 degrees Fahrenheit or above 84 degrees Fahrenheit. And so this table is showing for each year, if you look at the first column in 2008, there were 21 days that were below 0 degrees Fahrenheit. And then within those 21 days, the longest stretch of days that were below zero was 5 days. And then of all the stretches or spells that were below 0 degrees in the third column, you can see that the average was 3 days. So you can pick any temperature threshold you want. The menus would ask you, do you want to pick, 10 degrees or 11 degrees? Or you can instead ask the website to identify the 5th and the 95th percentile, and it'll automatically find that for the location that you're querying and then generate a table based on those temperatures. And that's actually what this example is showing. In Mammoth Hot Springs in Yellowstone, the 5th percentile temperature is 0 degrees Fahrenheit, and the 95th percentile is 84 degrees. So it just identified those and made a table. Some of the other things that we're working on for the website, I developed this with David Thoma in Bozeman. There's a water balance model, and I think some of you are familiar with this, but just briefly, it keeps track of all the places in the ecosystem that water can reside. So you have, soil water, and it can evaporate, and falls precipitation. And so the inputs for the model are weather station data. You have, depending on the type of weather station, it can be just simply temperature and precipitation, or if you're dealing with a raw station, you would have wind speed and humidity and solar radiation, things like that. The algorithm adapts depending on how much data is available. But it runs on a daily time step, and it tends to it tries to show you things like moisture deficit and soil water and where these different where the water is being partitioned in the ecosystem over time. And so here's just an example graph that comes out of the website. This is for Lovell, Wyoming, which is near Bighorn Canyon National Recreation Area. And it's just showing 2 years of output from the water balance model. On the left y-axis is moisture deficit, and on the right y-axis is soil water. And the basic take-home message of the graph is that you have wet years and dry years. 2014 was a wet year and a dry year. You can see that the green line, which is soil water, was higher in 2014 and obviously lower in 2015. And moisture deficit started a lot later in 2014, it's around April rather than sometime in February or March in 2015. And it's just nice to see, this is just a simple visual example. If you skip past this graph and look at the actual conditions in the field, 2014 was a wet year. These pictures were taken on basically the same date in 2014 versus 2015. And you can see that it was a lot greener in the 2014, which is identified as the wet year by the water balance model, versus 2015. Some of the other things that we're working on that you know we can generate sort of automatically out of the weather data that we're getting are the Keach-Byram drought index, which is used for predicting the likelihood of fire spread. So it's a measure of how deep or how dry the deeper levels of soil are. And so it has, on this top graph here, the higher you go, the more drought it is, the less water is in the soil. So it's a measure of deficit. So a KVDI of 450 means you need 4.5 inches to replenish the soil to field capacity. These are some measures that are used for fire prediction in the area around us. And the one down below is the 1,000-hour fuel moisture, which is a measure of the moisture of logs that are in the field by weight percent. And that's another thing that's used to predict fire spread. And kind of the cool thing about that is this graph that you're looking at on the bottom was generated from weather data, but it calibrates really well. So if you take that data that's in the bottom panel of this graph and compare it to actual fuel stick measures that were done in Yellowstone, you can see that the black line shows the output of the algorithm on a daily time step, and the red dots are actual measurements of fuel moisture in the field in Yellowstone, and there's a pretty good matchup there. So this gives you the potential of being able to predict fuel moisture without having to go out and actually make the empirical measurements. I was just going to quickly, I gave you all those examples. I didn't want to force you to watch me go through all the menus on the website. I just wanted to show you the website quickly. It's climateanalyzer.org. And the opening interface is just a series of maps that you can choose from. So this is the Greater Yellowstone area. And all of these icons are different types of weather stations. So you can click on any of these here, and it'll take you to the menus that let you make the different graphs and tables that I just showed you. That's sort of the more sciencey interface for people who are scientists that want to use the data. There's also a more popular science interface that we call the dashboards. So this is an example for Yellowstone. It's just a series of buttons that give you some of the quickest types of weather data and climate summaries that people are interested in. So for example, you can see here there's some forecasts. You can click on a drought monitor tab, and it'll give you a map of the area with a GIS layer that's provided by the U.S. Drought Monitor. So it's showing that right now Yellowstone is, a good portion of it is rated as abnormally dry by the Drought Monitor. You can also do things like look at departures. So this is, for a particular weather station, how much above or below average temperature and precipitation were relative to the 1981 to 2010 normals that are issued by NOAA. So you've got months on the x-axis, and on the top panel, you can see that, for example, October of 2016, minimum temperatures, average daily minimum temperatures, were quite a bit above average, and precipitation, which is on the bottom panel there, was nearly 350% of average. This is the south entrance to Yellowstone. You can also do things like look at snow maps. So this is from SnowDAS satellite imagery. The website generates maps that show snow cover in depth in terms of snow water equivalent and snow depth every day. So this is for the Yellowstone area and Grand Teton National Park. And you can, it archives all the historical data, so you can go back and look at any particular day since we started running the website. Let's see, I won't go through all these examples, but you can get other things too, like we have earthquake data that's updated by the USGS every hour, so you can get a map of that. Quite a few other options that I won't go into. That's a quick rundown on the, yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to ask, is this for all the park units that are part of the Rocky Mountain National Park Service monitoring network, or is it, how is the data centered? Is it around park units?
It is, yeah. So right now it's based on NPS INM network. So I have 12 INM networks that are signed up to use it. So I guess maybe the easiest way to show you that would be to go to the home page, and then you can see off of this map of the United States, those are all the networks that have signed up. So within all of those networks, all of the national parks that are served by those networks, there's about a 40-kilometer boundary around each park.
Okay, I see. Great, thank you.
Yeah, anybody else want to jump in? Just interrupt me at any time. I know I have limited time.
Yeah, not a whole lot of time, and we want to kind of get back to the management part of it, which was supposed to be today's focus, but go ahead.
Okay, so that's just the website, and then I was just going to briefly say that there was a study we did recently, which I guess this does have more management implications. It's we use downscaled climate data to predict what snowpack levels would be like in mid and late 21st century, and then look at the implications of that for snowmobile use. And there's a lot of things that snow influence, but this is something that I think is accessible to a lot of people, and it's also pretty clear cut. It's hard to predict how animals or something will respond to reduced snowpack, but there's a pretty clear relationship between how much snow you have and whether you can drive a snowmobile or not. So that was easier to analyze. And usually climate data don't have the resolution that you need to make a prediction like this, so there were a lot of steps, you know, bias correction and some temperature index equations that we used to get at how much snow there would be in each place. But this is the upshot take-home slide. This is a map of Yellowstone, and you can see that the colors on the road segments, which are the lines that go through the park, show you how much we're predicting or forecasting how often people will be able to use to drive snowmobiles or snow coaches in Yellowstone. Mid-century is 2031 to 2060, and late century is 2061 to 2090. It's a little bit deceiving. I just have one more slide, and then I'll stop. But these are just averages. So, for example, the red dots on the west entrance road, we're predicting 59% drivability. But if you look at it from this perspective on this slide, that the yellow line is 2031 to 2060. That's the average predicted snowpack over a water year during that 30-year period. But all the gray lines that are above and below that those lines are the actual individual model years. And you can see that some years are going to be quite low. If you assume that you need 10 centimeters of SWE, if you look at the y-axis there, there's quite a few years in which there's not enough snow during the whole year, really, to drive a snowmobile in Yellowstone. So there's a lot of variability above the mean, above and below the mean, which is one of the common things that you come across with climate change forecasting. I went really fast because I didn't want to go over my time, and that's all I have, so I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mike. Any questions? Okay, we're going to move on to Alden Shallcross, who's with the Bureau of Land Management from the Billings office. Alden, why don't you tell us what you do there, and then Mary can share your screen. I know you have a few slides.
Sure, yep. I'm a hydrologist, and I'm the soil, water, air, and riparian program manager for Montana, North Dakota, and South Dakota. Came up here about a year ago, and got about four or five slides to share.
So Alden, I gave you permit. There you go. Thanks.
Yep. Okay. So I guess it's a specific screen that I have to share on. Is that visible to you guys?
Yes, it is.
Okay, cool. BLM has a couple projects. Unlike some of the other individuals that have spoken today, ours are more, geared towards management applications or project projects with specific questions. Currently, we're doing some research with the USGS to estimate the impacts of climate change on prairie fish. We have a cooperative agreement with Montana Climate Office, which was initiated a couple months ago, to do two things. One, in response to a tremendous lack of soil moisture data across the state, we'll be collaborating with other interested groups to install met stations with soil moisture sensors installed at a couple different depths to correspond to the rooting depths, as well as the development of a web interface for viewing statewide data, a lot like what was presented by Mike Tercek. And then secondly, the application of NDVI sensors, so the normalized difference vegetation indices sensors, to validate and calibrate the satellite-derived estimates of drought and determine what specifically a drought indicator means to the plant phenology and production. Lastly, kind of a pet project of mine that's kind of in the planning stage is to run the BRAT tool, the Beaver Restoration and Assessment tool, to identify locations for beaver restoration. We realized that the watersheds are a sponge that have been reduced by the extirpation of beaver and early spring snowmelt. While we can't do much for the snowmelt right now, we can certainly do something to improve the storage. This is the first of two papers associated with the prairie stream study that we're doing with the USGS. As most of you probably know, the prairie streams in the region have been heavily impacted by land use changes, and many of the species are already in a very reduced state. So a couple years ago, BLM identified a prairie stream's focal area under our Healthy Lands Initiative. And this basically increases the priority of prairie streams for restoration and monitoring. And although there is an active and passive restoration component, this part of the project is really geared towards the identification of locations where changes to the hydrology and aquatic habitat associated with climate change will exceed the biological thresholds. So basically three models were utilized to do this project. The climate model is used to obtain the climatic inputs for the hydrologic model, and that's what this presentation, or that's what this paper, is describing. And the next step is to take the biologic models and couple them with this hydrologic model. And so I'm not sure what the timeline is for that. I know that they're working on it diligently right now. And all of these outputs were evaluated for the base years, which is 1982 to 99, and then through three future periods. So here's the first part of our Montana Climate Office partnership. As you can see in the upper left-hand corner, here's our real-time data for soil moisture. And it's pretty sparse. A lot of our neighbors have good data sets, but Montana is basically one giant data gap. So one of our first steps of this program was to really just expand the network. So we have a five-year agreement with the MCO, and each year we'll be installing around eight stations with the parameters that you can see in the bottom left-hand corner. See, one of the main differences between some of the other stations is that we're actually adding the NDVI sensors to this. So not only can we get a water balance, but we can relate all of that information to actual production and phenology on the rangelands. And then similarly to the previous presentation, not only is the raw data going to be available to the groups, but they're automating a number of processes that should be useful to land managers. And it's also going to be available in real time, accessed on your computer or on your cell phone. The part of this project that really gets me excited, though, is the NDVI sensors, because I think that there's just a lot of different ways that they can be used to advance our range and drought management. While we can already use satellite-derived estimates of greenness to identify drought conditions, we still need to know what the intensities mean on the ground. So if you have a specific pixel value for NDVI, what is that really telling you about the on-the-ground condition? For example, the figure at the top shows the difference in greenness at the Little Missouri River Basin in 2010, which was a wet year, and 2012, which was about 70% of normal, I believe. And as you can see, during both June and September 2010, the plants had a lot more chlorophyll, and it lasted a lot longer into the year. However, what we don't know is how do these greenness values specifically relate to things like phenology and production, which are really rather important for us in the grazing management side of the world. So we'll be sending staff out to each of these met stations to measure production and indicators of plant health so that we can correlate the vegetation data with the NDVI and soil moisture data. the goal is to determine whether we can formulate conclusions. For example, the NDVI values in your pasture on this date are only X percent of normal, so we expect that the annual production is X percent of normal, and will therefore require trigger monitoring, herd reduction, early removal, some sort of adaptive management. Similarly, we want to know, is it possible to relate the NDVI values to things like palatability and nutrition content so that the remotely sensed data can then be used to predict changes in herd behavior? For example, we know that when upland forest senesces, livestock commonly shift preference to riparian wetland vegetation and disproportionately impact those areas. Therefore, can we use these relationships to objectively establish season of use and grazing permits, or even establish drought-specific grazing use criteria like stubble height, stream bank alteration, woody browse that would apply when those NDVI thresholds are reached? The point is, the existing satellite data provides a lot of information that could be more useful with a better understanding of what the indices mean to vegetation on the ground, and that's kind of where we're going with this. Lastly, kind of a pet project, but I don't know how well it relates to the talk, so I'll just briefly skip through it. But the Beaver Restoration Assessment Tool is a tool that was developed down in Utah to identify ideal locations for beaver restoration because of the obvious benefits to beaver in many locations as a way of keeping water on the landscape longer and certainly addressing hydrologic or even I guess I'd say agricultural drought, but probably not a good example there. Essentially, we're trying to find ways that we can build our partnerships together, and by doing so, we'll be identifying these optimal locations for sighting beaver, as well as adding in some additional layers that tell us where we're likely to have issues with land uses, such as irrigation, locations where it would probably peeve people. I think Utah had a pretty good success in running this and developing partnerships and even getting a statewide plan. So I'd like to start with the model in some of our focal areas, the drought resiliency focal areas, and see where it takes us, but hopefully be able to build some relationships and build this model into some of our NEPA so that we can start planning to take these actions.
Hey, thank you.
Sure.
Linh, did you have a question? Or were you at the end of your presentation, Alden?
I'm at the end.
Okay. Linh, I think Linh had a question for you about, Linh, are you there?
Hi, this is Linh. Yeah, I just put it in the chat. Those new stations, are they just, you said they're going to be in the rangelands. The Montana climate work, are they going to be putting anything in the forest systems as well? Have they thought about that, or is that they're just working with you in the rangelands?
Putting them in where, I'm sorry?
In the forest systems, the new stations for soil moisture.
Yeah, so... there are a number of different partners. They're calling it the MesoNet network. And I think that there could be some other individuals that are interested in those areas. It initially started around the agricultural lands. And so I know that's the current focus. I'm not up to speed on whether they're getting up into the forested or montane areas, though.
Okay. All right. I'll contact our office. Thanks.
Yep.
Any other questions for Alden? Okay, thank you very much. Linh, you're up next, so Mary, I think we'll hand over the screen to you, and you can introduce yourself and your position with the Forest Service.
Hey, everyone. Let's see, can you guys see my screen?
Yes, we can.
I just did this. Pulled together some slides on the slide here, so hopefully it'll work out. So I'm Linh Hoang. I'm the Inventory Monitoring Assessment and Climate Change Coordinator for Region 1 of the Forest Service, which covers northern Idaho, Montana, and parts of North and South Dakota. So we are looking at, in Region 1, developing two different levels of monitoring and inventory right now. We have a new planning role for forest planning that requires us to look at both the plan level monitoring programs at each of our forests and grasslands, and then also a broad scale monitoring strategy that looks at where there's deficiencies and where it makes sense for the resource to really be asking the same questions and looking at the same indicators at scales larger than one planning unit. Let me give you an idea. The plan or the monitoring rule requires us to look at on what we call the Big 8 monitoring questions, which really, you know, evolve into many more questions than just 8 questions. But we have to have monitoring questions around watersheds, around ecological conditions, and key characteristics of terrestrial and aquatic systems, focal species, to assess the conditions of important aquatic or important ecological conditions, and then also the ecological conditions that are important for any of our at-risk species. Looking at recreation questions around visitor use and satisfaction, and then looking at changes related to climate change and any other of our other stressors. Also looking at our meeting our desired conditions, and then also looking at soil productivity. That's the last one. Actually, we do have a 9th one that was added to us for us to also have questions around social, economic, and cultural sustainability. The focus of our questions that we have right now are really around looking at changes of indicators that tell us something about how well we are managing our lands related to what we say we're going to do in our forest plans. And I've been meeting with many of the resource folks and asking why they're asking these questions, what indicators they're using, and how we can really be thinking about using some common indicators, some common methodologies, some common protocols, reportings, et cetera, that we can do here at the regional level so that every unit's not rolling on their own. And so that's what I've been working on for the last year and a half now. And we have a set of management questions that are regional in scope and a set of and the monitoring that needs to go with those management questions and a select set of indicators and how we measure those indicators for some of our resources. Now we've gone through workshops with forested vegetation, with non-forested vegetation, including the invasives and rangelands, and then also with our watershed group looking at fish and water and soils. And actually we didn't finish soils. And then I think we also have one more here on vegetation one, but we have one on fire and infective disease as well. So we do have a list of questions and the indicators that we are going to be measuring over the long term for these particular questions. Most of our data sources really are from existing data sets. We had a few in the conversations I've had with the program managers here at the regional office and at the resource specialists down at our forest, where they've been talking and asking about new inventories that need to occur and new monitoring that needs to occur because our existing protocols, existing data sets really aren't going to answer the questions that they want to ask. So we are in the process of talking those through, looking at the feasibility, looking at how we can partner with folks and so forth. But for the majority of it, and it is criticism from some of our publics right now, is that we are really looking at only existing data sets at this point in time and asking questions of our existing data sets. So let me see the other questions. I have been talking with some of the other regions as well, because in addition to looking at indicators and common questions that go beyond one planning unit, we're also being asked to look at indicators and questions that go beyond regions. For example, we could be looking at avian bird monitoring across regions, doing it in the same way. We could be looking at invasive species inventories that are happening in the same ways across larger landscapes than just our region. So I've been talking to other inventory monitoring assessment coordinators across other regions and working with someone from Colorado State as well to help think about these things. So I'm really excited that Tina and Yvette are pulling this group together, because a lot of what we do monitor is what Yvette said earlier, what we want to monitor is just monitoring the response or the changes that are happening from climate. And there are many different climate indicators that could have implications to our resources. And we are really mostly either monitoring, direct monitoring the resource, or monitoring some sort of proxy for that resource related to the management questions that we have. So And I can give examples of what we've pulled together so far. Nothing is concrete at this point. Everything's in draft. My next phase really is to work with some of the other resources. We need to refine the wildlife questions and indicators and measures for many of our species. And we also need to work with our recreation folks and ecosystem services folks to also be thinking about a lot of the climatic factors that are going to be important for those resources, what questions we could be asking, and what data we actually have or don't have for those resources. And that's it.
Great, thanks, Lynn. Hey, I have a question. When you were talking about the Big Eight, is that like a Region 1 list of questions that grew out of your planning process, or is that actually part of sort of Forest Service policy or litigation case law?
This is, the Big Eight questions are from our 2012 planning rule. So it's
they are in the planning rule.
They are in the planning rule. Like I said, it's just a framework. I mean, these eight, you can just consider them, eight main categories. Within each of those, we're going to have probably a comprehensive set of questions for those and indicators and measures. But again, we're trying to not have every unit roll on their own on this, and this is why we're doing the broad scale strategy, is where can we find efficiencies to help with each unit not doing their own monitoring, doing something at a larger scale. I mean, for example, we're trying to pull together a mesocarnivore monitoring program, working with Rocky Mountain Research and with some of our state partners in Idaho and Montana right now, to do a large-scale monitoring program for some of our mesocarnivores. And we've put quite a bit of money into this, and we want it to be something that each of our folks are using and not doing their own inventories of wolverine or own inventories of lynx and so forth, that we're going to be using this large-scale program.
Thanks. Any other questions for Lynn? Okay. We're going to move on to Britta. Britta, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself and what you do, and Mary will hand over to the screen.
Okay, thank you. So my name is Britta Bierwagen, and I am with the EPA's Office of Research and Development, and let's see if you can see my screen. All right, can you guys see my presentation?
Yes, we can.
Awesome. All right, so I have been working with various parts of EPA for a number of years now, and mainly looking at bioassessment programs and from the EPA context, biocriteria and biomonitoring types of programs that that run through our Office of Water and our EPA regions, and then down to the states and tribes. And in working with them, we've kind of started to develop these regional monitoring networks. And because of where I am within ORD, which has been focused on climate change and global change questions and thinking about impact and vulnerability and adaptation, we really wanted to ask this question from the climate change point of view and look at these monitoring networks as being able to detect climate change effects. So I'll talk a little bit about the work that we've been doing in streams and really that the questions that have been driving this whole work was overarching, how will climate change impact aquatic ecosystems? And then more specifically, and within the EPA context, what is it that bioassessment programs need to know to respond, and how will they maintain their ability to assess condition and detect impairment in the future? And so we kind of started with this conceptual model that climate change is the context within which everyone is doing their work. And so from a streams ecosystems point of view, well, there are abiotic responses and biotic responses, and on the right are a whole bunch of metrics that we could be looking at or indicators that we could be looking at. And clearly this is not what we'll be doing for everything, but this is kind of where we were starting the conversation. Is what does it make sense to look at if the climate effects can be, so broad or so varied? What is it that we, need to really start with in order to still effectively do, everyone do their jobs in the future? So then, kind of stepping closer to, what the programs are actually doing, why is there this need for regional monitoring networks? And it's varied. From their day-to-day point of view, climate change is certainly not at the forefront of what they're dealing with, but it is something that, over the last few years with a variety of, executive orders and all sorts of other, attentions on the climate change issue, quantifying and monitoring these changes in baseline conditions and being able to understand what climate effects are is really important. But in addition to that, just understanding these, long-term data and having comparable data across the states and tribes so that you can understand broader regional patterns is also very important, and that's not something that historically we've done. You can look at kind of state monitoring programs and essentially look across 50 states and come up with 50 different methods, and that poses some, analytical problems if you want to look across state lines or any other kind of organizational boundaries. And then also to fill a gap in how we've been doing monitoring. So historically, a lot of the biological assessment programs and have been based on kind of a five-year rotating design so that you weren't necessarily going back to the same place every year and monitoring the same sites every year, but you had this five-year recurrence interval, and so you were, in your design able to do this comparison of your reference sites to potentially impaired sites to detect impairments, but you weren't really getting a full picture necessarily of what your reference condition, what your best conditions were or sites were doing. And so there was this gap of, more frequent biological data, and certainly as technologies have progressed, continuous, thermal and hydrologic data. So initially, what we looked at and the support that our part of the organization has provided was basically to think about the stream sites and think about classification and some other practical considerations for long-term monitoring. So, what type of sites do we want to look at? And this has been really a very, bottom-up approach that we've been working with the states and the tribes and taking their input. This has not been, dictated by Office of Research and Development or EPA broadly. So, what types of sites are of interest? What are the most critical ones? Where's the need? How many of them should we do? So we've been supporting them with analyses, for how long, how frequently, and exactly what are we monitoring and using what methods? And then we've also talked about, vulnerability assessments, and I think this is really where it comes in to the management conversation. But in doing this and in walking through this process, there are a lot of barriers that exist, and part of them are, there's no long-term funding, programs and protocols across organizational units and jurisdictional boundaries are not aligned, and communication can be challenging with this many players. So throughout the years, we've come up with a few resources to help with this. So we've got some reports that discuss, some of the finer points of, site selections and the methods that we would like to agree on and use to collect these baseline data, and to also show, from a decision-making point of view, how the data can be used, why it's important to establish these networks now and to look at these baselines now, and be able to have the data available for to answer specific questions, not just in, you know, 15 or 20 years when they'll be really salient for climate impact, but also in the near term for other management decisions. And so we've started, and really this is mainly because of how interest came about, and as I mentioned, it's very much a bottom-up effort. So we started in the Northeast, and then we worked with our Southeastern states and the Mid-Atlantic, and it has now grown beyond that, and I'll show you a map of where those locations are currently. And then we've also worked with folks from the Forest Service and from USGS to put together this guide on what best practices are for collecting data using these continuous sensors. So that's not something that all of our state and tribe and regional partners had experience with, and other agencies had a lot of experience with it. And so we've put together this resource, this report that's also available online, and it really talks about, you know, how you deploy these sensors, how you best collect the data. It goes into, you know, quality assurance, and we really wanted to do this to maximize our potential for data comparability across these very disparate units. And then from a more, I guess, internal EPA point of view, you know, we wanted to have a true, you know, quality assurance project plan that the states and the tribes could really use. So we've also come up with that. And it's really just a guideline for, you know, what it is that we're asking people to do. Okay, so this is the map of where we are right now. The black dots are actually where people have been monitoring and where people have been collecting data. And it's been, you know, the Northeast has probably 5 or so years of data now, and the Midwest, particularly, you know, Kansas, Nebraska, Iowa, Missouri, they have 1 year of data. They're the newest. And then actually the upper Midwest, they have their sites selected but haven't really collected any data yet. And then we're working with various other states right now to, you know, see what kinds of networks they might be interested in, and potentially, you know, folks from this across these sets of states and regions in the Rocky Mountains. And then just more specifically, you know, what is it that people are actually collecting? We're asking them to collect biological data. A lot of the focus has been on benthic macro invertebrates, but a lot of other places are doing fish and parasitin as well. And then, as I mentioned, continuous temperature. This is for both air and water. And then some measures of continuous, you know, water level or other hydrology, depending on where they are. So sometimes the sites are close enough to USGS gauges that they can use those data, and other times these are more headwater sites, and so we've had to put in other instrumentation. And oftentimes, actually, the states have been partnering with their, you know, local USGS field offices to do some, you know, sharing of the monitoring burden, particularly from the state point of view. A lot of the folks going out there are biologists and not hydrologists, and it really, you know, helps to be a collaborative effort in this case. And then they've also been doing the habitat, you know, water chemistry and some other things. And some of those are continuous sensors, sometimes like conductivity, and other times it's just the, you know, discrete grab samples. The way that we've laid it out is, again, nothing is prescriptive. So in our report, the co-op, we've put down what the target is of, you know, the method, the data, how we would like the data to be collected, and then describe some other, you know, essentially levels of rigor. And so, you know, states can do what they can and understand, you know, maybe if they're only at this level one, their data might not be able to be used across the whole network. But they can also, you know, as resources become available, potentially build on that, or if they can collaborate with some other agency to collect those data, then, you know, that may work. And then for others, they're already doing more than what we're shooting for, kind of the comparable goal, and that's fine as well. We can certainly work with that. And then this is just a brief example. So, for example, for the bugs, you know, we're asking people to look at 300, count 300 organisms, but, you know, we realize there's variability across what the states are able to do, and so this is kind of an example of, you know, if you can only do presence absence, well, you would be, you know, essentially at the level one. Okay, and so just to briefly go into, you know, what is it that we're doing with the data that we're collecting, particularly the continuous data. There is a lot of it that is coming in, but, you know, other than just responding to, you know, climate change and understand climate impact, this is also, you know, helping states answer other questions, you know, understanding recovery from extreme events. So Vermont has been quite successful in using that. They've been monitoring for quite a while, and then Hurricane Irene hit, and they had some great, you know, pre-hurricane baseline data, and now are looking at recovery from that event and doing a lot of work in that, not just in streams, but also wetlands. There's also been quite a few applications of the data that the states have been collecting in terms of just looking at their baselines and variability from site to site in terms of just their reference quality sites. They've been using it to look at revising designated uses based on some of these other data that they're collecting, and looking at, you know, changes in spatial distribution of specific biological indicators that they're interested in. You know, we're hoping that this can also inform vulnerability assessments and help, you know, depending on how you, what goals and what questions you're trying to answer with the monitoring network and where you're going to put these sites, that it can help prioritize restoration in order to, you know, facilitate resilience or building resilience in watersheds. And then, of course, the data can also be used on the modeling side that you're either you're validating or using the data to project future changes in stream conditions. So there are a whole host of applications, and we actually have different fact sheets geared towards different, you know, parts of the agencies and you know, the state organizations of, you know, what they can do near term with the data versus long term. Oh, sorry, I always forget that there are pretty pictures that go with this graphic. And then data management, I realize this is something that other agencies have solved, particularly NOAA and NASA, who deal with a lot of continuous data on an ongoing basis, but unfortunately it is not a problem that EPA and the states and tribes have necessarily solved. So from our point of view, we don't really have a system that can currently accommodate all of the types of data that our partners are collecting. So, you know, while USGS has all of this, it is really just for their data. And from the EPA point of view, most of the data that have been collected up to now have been these, you know, discrete. You go out, you take your samples, it's all one measurement. So the continuous data has presented more of an issue. But there is a vision, for sure, and you know, we realize that the data management software, you know, if everyone is buying it, that's quite a costly solution. So we've been working with our partners for an interim solution and doing some training on, you know, some R scripts. So at the very least, we are preparing the data with some, you know, consistency checks and some quality assurance and getting everything in a consistent format so that once we have a data management system, at least from the EPA point of view, then there will be, you know, a whole host of data that will be ready to upload and won't sit out on, you know, someone's computer as a little data orphan. And that's, you know, very quickly an overview of what we've been doing with the regions, and a ton of people have been involved over the years and have contributed to this project. And I really am looking forward to conversations with all of you, you know, how this this type of project can, you know, fit in with where you may be going, and in trying to, you know, look at the monitoring, particularly from more of a management point of view of answering, you know, some of those very specific questions.
Great, thank you, Britta. Does anyone have questions for Britta right now about her presentation or in general?
Hi, Britta. This is Andy Ray. So, do you offer SOPs and things like that to folks interested in participating in the network? So SOPs on installing and maintaining the gauging stations at the at individual stream sites?
Yeah, so we have that that best practices report, and then kind of the quality assurance project plan that does speak to we didn't quite call it SOPs, but essentially what the best practices are and what you how you'd want to do it kind of step by step. And so that everybody has some, or you know, that we have some level of consistency there. So we do have those things, and I'm happy to share those with anyone who wants them.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So this is Yvette again. I just kind of want to point out that today the way we set this up is, and part of this is, this is not my monitoring is not my area of expertise. And we're all coming from very different perspectives, and even just in the federal family who we're talking to here, very different ways of thinking about climate change and monitoring in general, in terms of the resources or the impacts or the climate tools and information. Part of the purpose of this was to determine, tell me if I'm wrong, Britta or Tina, if we have an interest in this part of the world in developing a regional monitoring network. Is that right?
Yes. This is Tina. That was part of what we were originally thinking, is it would be good to hear from this group as to whether or not there might be interest in, you know, kind of building a network that may address multiple needs and what that would look like if there is interest.
Right. So Britta kind of gave us sort of a look at how EPA is thinking about those in other parts of the country right now. And we can see from at least some of the managers that we heard from today, there's a lot of different ways that we're thinking about climate change and monitoring in general. We heard from Mike Tercek, who contracts with the Park Service INM network, but we haven't gotten the talk from Andy about sort of the INM network monitoring program and how that's set up. I'm assuming we can do that next time. Is that right, Andy? Dave sent me an email that said that would be okay if we did it next time, or if people want to stay on longer, we could do it. We could continue today's discussion.
Sure. I'm happy to talk whenever. I know David is not available next time, so he's got some slides he could share. I will just say, though, that we rely heavily on the products that Mike Tercek is producing using Climate Analyzer, and in fact we've worked closely with managers asking them, you know, what kinds of graphs and tabular data sets they find useful, and so we've used those a lot in our we've used Climate Analyzer and its products a lot in our reporting, and you know, we can share examples with that if you'd like. But David's got some examples, and I'm also happy to talk more about the Park Service specific work next time.
Well, David, if you want to, we still have a little bit of time. I think I allotted like an hour and a half to 2 hours, but I wasn't sure if everybody could stay on that long. But let's go ahead and do yours since you can't make the next one. And we have sort of, we did add in Andrea and then Mike, which was more of a science presentation, but that's okay. We'll just kind of hear all of this stuff over the next couple webinars. And then for the third webinar in January, we'll kind of have a bigger discussion about what it might look like, what it would take. But let's move into Dave Thoma then, if people still have time. And Dave will kind of share with us the perspective from the Park Service and the Rocky Mountain INM network. Mary, okay, can you?
Can you see my screen?
It's coming.
Okay, yeah, so I'll try to be really brief since I know we're near the end here. And I'm going to talk mostly about how we assess climate exposure and climate sensitivity. So really we're interested in that because it informs what the potential impact might be, which again could play into our decisions about management that might afford some relative advantages in terms of capacity for adapting. So just to give you an example, this is some data that I pulled from Mike Tercek's Climate Analyzer showing the deficit in this year at August 1st, tracking what it was in 1988, and then the corresponding outcome from that, the big fires that we had in Yellowstone and the Grand Tetons were the largest since 1988. And then this is a photo from Andy Ray of the low flow, lowest recorded flow on the Lamar River in Yellowstone about that same time. So these deficit conditions were recorded and available to us because of the Climate Analyzer website 2 weeks before those big fires erupted and before this fish kill in the Yellowstone River. So that's just to give you an indication that qualitatively these water balance metrics that Mike can calculate for us now are useful, but specifically I want to use just a couple of case studies here and talk about some of the findings from the monitoring work that we've done. So this first one is describing whitebark pine sensitivity. So we use our water balance model at all these locations across the ecosystem to track the climate conditions that occur coincident with tree mortality. And so this figure here represents the sensitivity of the trees to water deficit. And so the y-axis is the probability of mortality. And on the bottom tier, we see if no beetles are present, the probability of mortality is very low, which suggests that the trees are not dying from drought. They're dying from other causes. But in the middle panel, or the middle figure there, or the middle line there, you can see that when the trees are of smaller size and attacked by beetles, their probability of dying increases as the deficit increases. So specifically, if we are about 2.5 to 3 inches below normal precipitation in the summer, that increases the probability of mortality by about 20 or 30%. So that's substantial. So this allows us to play some what-if games because it's not just the temperature and precipitation that drive the probability of mortality. It's these other factors like deficit, which are contingent upon the site conditions. So the slope, the aspect, and the soil properties all affect what the deficit is in addition to what the temperature and precipitation are. So I think in the interest of time, I'm going to skip through this slide quickly, but it's just a sensitivity analysis that indicates that soil properties and aspect are especially important. So this next case study is similar to what Alden described earlier, where we use an NDVI and climate data to try to understand how sensitive vegetation is to climate. This is just a satellite image of Yellowstone from last summer. You can see the large fire scars that are circled in red. But along the northern range, you can also see the vegetation in the meadows there is stressed. So when we evaluate the sensitivity of landscape greenness to availability of water, we see that not all places are equally sensitive, in this case, to drought. We find that wet meadows and alpine areas are more sensitive. So the further down these bars go, the more sensitive the habitat is to drought. And if we look at a particular place, like around Tower Junction, and we plot deficit through time, we can see it's increasing. And the bars, the red, yellow, and green bars, represent what we call pivot points. They're not really biological or ecological thresholds. They're just an indication of where you expect greenness to be above or below average. And so what we see is that the probability of exceeding a deficit pivot point for a habitat type like wet meadows is becoming increasingly frequent. So they're being drought stressed more frequently. And if this trend continues, we may exceed the deficit pivot point for wet meadow environments almost every year. And that gives us some indication of which habitat types might be more susceptible sooner to climate change. So one more example, this is a study from Capitol Reef, where we were, again, trying to answer some of the same kind of questions Alden alluded to earlier. But primarily, what we thought we might try first is just to try to see if NDVI in these desert environments responds to precipitation. It turns out I couldn't find a good signal with precipitation, so we started playing with the water balance variables, and we were able to find really strong relations between different combinations of water balance variables that changed by month. So early in the growing season, evapotranspiration and precipitation were really important. Middle of the season, when they have drought conditions, a deficit was important, and then soil moisture was important later in the growing season. So we were able to do a pretty good job predicting what the NDVI would be in these desert environments just by looking at the climate and water balance. So as Alden alluded to, there's a lot of good management implications from this. I'll just skip those, and I'll leave it here. I'll just let you read the screen if you're interested, just in the interest of time. Any questions?
Thanks, Dave. That is good stuff. Questions for Dave?
Dave, I saw that you put a paper out in 2016 on this. Any chance you can email it to us?
Yeah, sure.
That'd be awesome.
Is this Alden?
Yeah, that's Alden. Yep.
Okay, sure.
You know, Yvette, this is Tina. The one thing that listening to all these great different approaches and monitoring pieces of information also get me thinking about, there's all of you guys have been working on kind of some of these really complex issues. And so it'd be also really great to get your all thoughts in the upcoming series of webinars about how we can potentially integrate some of these approaches and where that makes sense and what that might look like. So a question for the group to ponder as we move into our next series of webinars in the coming months.
Thanks, Tina. Other questions or comments for Dave or anyone else? Okay, our next call is on December 14th, so that's 5 weeks away. We have mixed things up a little. I was kind of thinking about it like first we'd focus on management, then we'd kind of explore more of the science and information. But, you know, this is okay. We have to accommodate people's schedules, and that's okay. So we'll hear a little bit more about the Park Service I&M Network next time and the work that Andy Ray and Adam Sepulveda are doing. We'll also hear from Chuck Hawkins at Utah State University, who has a career in aquatic monitoring, and Dan Isaac from the U.S. Forest Service Rocky Mount Research Station, who's done quite a bit recently developing an aquatic monitoring system that's regional and national. And so I would ask that those of you that are going to talk to us next time, and anyone else who would like to have something else to share from the standpoint of science, feel free to sort of challenge us on what are some of the questions and things we need to think about as we go into a discussion about the feasibility of a regional monitoring network. Understanding that most of us are managers, we think about the job we have to get done and the most efficient way to get it done. We try to use the best science, but oftentimes there's science questions that we aren't thinking about right at the beginning because we need to kind of get to an endpoint. So if you could help us or there's a lot of really good scientists on the call today, come prepared with some questions that are going to challenge us in terms of how we put this together. And like Tina said, some suggestions on how we might take the work that's going on among our respective organizations and develop a network along the lines of maybe what Britta has presented, or if that needs to be a little different, what that might look like. Are there any other sort of closing comments for today? I will have this, we have recorded this, so we'll circulate that in case you want to go back and refer to anything or read it. I'm assuming nobody has anything sensitive here. Let me know if you do. But I think all of this is sort of public information, so no big deal to circulate. And I'll send that out when Mary has that recording for me. Anything else before we close? Well, thank you so much for sticking with us. I know it took us a while to kind of get to this point, and we'll look forward to talking again on December 14th.
Thank you.
Thank you, Yvette. Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks for organizing. Bye-bye.